First of all, my presentation is organized in terms of discussing with you the idea of legal research. So we have research objectives or so-called purpose of research. We have review of literature. Once we have a purpose drawn up vaguely in our mind, we do the review of literature. I will show you a sample research and a small research from Economic and Political Weekly. How many of you have read Economic and Political Weekly? How many of you have read the American Journal of International Law, Oxford Journal of Legal Studies, or Cambridge Journal of Legal, because you have legal database, or many other journals are there in the field of law. So we can take one example and see. Hypothesis and research questions, or hypothesis or research questions, which form the basis of our inquiry, and then formulation and testing of hypothesis, and then how the entire legal research process happens. So some of these things include identification and selection of the research problem. By problem we mean something that is looking for a solution. So I'll explain each of these concepts quickly. Choice of a theoretical framework or conceptual model for the research problem and its relationship with previous research. That's where literature review comes in. Formulation of the problem or hypothesis to be tested and the specification of its objective and its scope, and design of the inquiry or the experiment, if any you are doing. Where do we do the experiment? There is a research where this was done by political science students, political science researchers who were trying to look at the justice system, who played a moot court and then they, or mock trial, and then they wanted to see the jury outcome and the judge outcome. Some of the retired judges were made to sit as panel and some jury were made to sit as panel. How many of the decisions of the jury agreed with the judges? So there is a kind of experiment there where we call as, what is experiment? In experiment, sir was talking about, the deeper nuance I would like to share with you. In experiment, what do we do? You mix, calcium, and nitric acid. And then you want to see how it changes the color. What happens? There is a quick reaction. Any acid reacts very quickly because it's a strong chemical. And then there is a certain change experienced in the mixture. So experiment, observation, inference. So if you mix calcium or lime in a certain proportion with certain proportion of nitric acid, there is a certain change. It may be in the form of a color, smell. So empirical, you know, sense organs we are using. Color, visual sense. And there is a sound of effervescence. There is a formation of effervescence. So there is a physical change as well which you observe. There is a quantity or a proportion that you use. This is called calibration. So the measurement, you know. So these kinds of using sense experience to observe the change in the form of introducing a stimulus and seeing the response, stimulus and response. Logically, go back to my example of watching the mock trial and then the jury concluding and the judges concluding and the correlation or agreement or disagreement between their conclusions. How many of them go for conviction? How many of them go for acquittal if it is a hearing on a murder trial? And if it is a trial, you know, the whole of evidence gathering, etc. Do you get the example? Yeah. So this is where we see the design of that experiment or inquiry. We could hold that trial and we could test the awareness of, a group of people in this part of the Bangalore city. How much are they aware of court procedures? And our concept is that people are increasingly developing apathy towards formal legal system. And one of the statistics says only 10% of the disputes end up in the court. Is that true? What is there in the previous research, in the text literature available, is that true? So you are experimenting it. You are inquiring it or you are experimenting it. You are experimenting by showing this trial and then you are seeing how many of them are aware, not aware, how many of them understood. That means they have never been to the court. In our parents' time, invariably, people would go and observe the procedure. It was a heyday of democracy. People were very worked up with the democratic institutions and court was like an odd institution, you know, respected institution. Today also that respect is there, but But people are increasingly considering it as a third-party institution, unlike us who are law students or lawyers, you know. So this kind of design which you make in terms of stimulus and response, you give a stimulus to your audience and then see their response, or you give a stimulus to those whom you want to study, or you give a stimulus to a group of people and then you observe. In our research, legal research, we can't give stimulus to calcium or potassium or nitrogen. We have to give stimulus to people because it's a behavioral research. I'll give you a second example of stimulus. Look at those children who are stuck in custody battle between two parents who are separated or divorced. How far does the child go through the experience of internal alienation and social alienation, or alienation from that parent who is living far away? So how does the court intervene? Already Mumbai courts have come out with what we call as parenting plan, and they have drawn this up based on the very strong emphasis on psychological dimensions, child right convention, the rights of the child, putting the child's right in the center, because child is yet to be fully formed as an individual. Have you heard of this? Parental alienation, parenting plan, have you heard of? Yeah? Parenting plan, what all considerations come and how do you arrive at a parenting plan? And there, family court doesn't operate like a court. Family court takes the mode of conciliation, mediation, counseling. That's why the whole Family Court Act was adopted way back in the 1980s, in order to see that this dispute, family dispute, doesn't become really a dispute, because there is no winner in a family dispute. All are losers in some or other way. So now you understand, suppose you are putting that child in the center, then you will have to comply with so many ethical dimensions as well, and sensitivity of the child and parental consent, both parents will have to consent. So many things are there. So researching the child could be difficult, but researching the parenting plan, different kinds of parenting plan at the center, rather than child's welfare, you know. And how far the rights of the child under the convention, what are the rights? Safety, security, well-being, entertainment, education, full development, you know, full personal potential development. How far are they conducive, these parenting plans? I know of a child who had to travel two flights the child had to take with the mother to meet the father, because the father has more money and more time also to think of litigation. So he has put a petition in the Supreme Court, and the child had to go all the way. The mother had to sacrifice her governmental job. For those days, she was in a very important, you know, case kind of job. So we had to use psychological evidence to show that this is harming the child. And truly, there was a lot of behavioral difficulties which the child experienced, because the child was alienated from the father for very long. For him, he is like any other stranger, you know. So this kind of facilitation, even the judges are incentivized, because they want to be seen as equality and they want to be seen as progressive judges. They want to be following the previous precedents. So our idea as researchers is not going to pedestalize judges. You pedestalize judge, you're compromising truth. It's not going to be kind to anybody, like the names mentioned. I don't take any name, Nariman or others, you know. I would have a good word to say if it connects and it fulfills my idea of truth, as I have evidence from the previous literature and in my parameter of analysis. So cultivate that independence of thinking. You don't have to follow because I told her, Professor Bhatt told her, Mr. Subbarao told. It's that independence which is very important for the researcher. So from that point of view, your design of experiment or inquiry should be so picture perfect or foolproof that it does not give scope for any bias. Next, definition and measurement of variables. So I told already about variables. What examples of variables can you give? If the dependent variable, the variable which you are going to investigate, is going to be on, let us say, something like the standard of compliance to human rights norms, like I am now reading on Nagoya Protocol, how far India has complied with the standards within Nagoya Protocol, what are the other variables that I can think of? What about the compliance in relation to indigenous people's traditional knowledge? Traditional knowledge is a parameter which is there in the convention. When I'm seeing, I'm going to a community and I'm seeing how far their traditional knowledge has been interfered with in the name of, let us say, open access, you know, so access and benefit sharing. If it has been interfered with, then is it prevented from being used? Is it ignored that they are the stewards, original stewards of knowledge? So these are the kinds of deeper variables which I will develop and analyze it. And I may apply to one community in Chhattisgarh, or I may apply to a number of communities elsewhere, or I may even pick one instance like the Kani tribe, the Jeevani case, and I will analyze that model in depth and show in terms of the different variables impacting on that. Later in the evening, I'll show you the variables which we used, such as education, for example, awareness of rights, the sensitivity of the courts in relation to human trafficking cases for sexual exploitation, you know. So that's what I'll be dealing with in the evening. So these concepts will become very, very clear when you apply it to, when you work with it, you know, you don't master or even understand unless you do the research. It's very easy to tell about research, but you have to do the research. It's like cooking. You may have hundreds of recipes, but when you watch that master chef, you have some kind of better gratification than when you read a recipe in a magazine. But when you yourself do with the master chef, you learn it. So that's why I was thinking somewhere we can incorporate an exercise. Then identification of the suitable population for the study and sampling procedure. I was giving you this example of a trial. Now, if that trial were to be demonstrated in front of a number of people, who are those people? How will you pick them? So your population could be stakeholders in the judicial system, or they could be simply citizens in Kamanahalli, correct? Kamanahalli. So from Kamanahalli, if you want to select citizens, and you want to try how far they are aware of the criminal trial, then it is awareness testing, and then you can't bring all, let us say, 20,000 population to this small hall. You will have to pick the population in such a way that sample has to be representative of that universe. So first you identify that universe, you see the characteristics and features, and you identify the segmentation or nuances or uniqueness. So from that you pick the sample, but at the same time don't ignore age and other kind of factor or criteria like education, exposure, you know, somebody who has been a court clerk all his life, if he appears in that sample or she appears, their responses will be different. So these will have to be identified. So those procedures you do that, and then tools and techniques for gathering data. When they are observing this trial, how do you know they are aware? You can't have a cacophony of everybody talking. That could be a good session, but it can't be a research finding. So to reduce it to finding and then outcome and report, you will have to issue some kind of a tool to gather their responses in a scientific manner. So what is that tool? Either you can circulate a questionnaire, which will have certain what we call as options, which they will select. We call them as codes, you know, in the form of codes. So you code those, indicate those responses, you code them, you put them together, and then you will know their level of awareness and you will interpret those results. But the other form of questionnaire, the other form of tool that we use is a set of broad questions, and then some of the volunteers we have selected who are research assistants will take a group of 10, they will sit with them and fill those questions, answers, that is interview schedule. So interview schedule can be broad questions, or even in interview schedule we may have options which you will tick mark. Now other than that, we can even think of showing that trial and then each group sitting together, and then you allowing them to speak around 3 or 4 simple indicative points. They discuss, as they discuss you record them, you generate responses, and then you identify the responses and collate them. Focus group discussion, where you have a focal point for generating that discussion. So the other two could be quantified. If you have used the SPSS or quantification technique, Whereas in focus group discussion, it is qualitative because those subjective responses, their sentences which they use, the outcome which is there is further summarized and then it is brought into the frame of outcome of the, I mean, results, and then it is interpreted in relation to the question or hypothesis that you have generated in the beginning as the basis of this research. I hope I have made sense.
Yes.
All of you can follow?
Yes.
You have followed, I hope. Now, that data which you gather, you can edit it, you can code it, you can process it. Then you analyze the data and use of appropriate statistical procedure for summarizing and for statistical inference. And then you put them together, you tabulate them, there are tables created. Then you project them in terms of interrelationship of variables or the extent of variables in graphical format. You have the graphs, you have the tables. And then you have statistical inference, and based on, then between the variables, what kind of relationship could be there? We were researching on human trafficking, and we saw that there was a in terms of appearance in Karnataka, 60% of the sex workers were confined to Bangalore city. But in terms of origin, more than 55% emerged from four districts which are on the border of Maharashtra and Hyderabad. Hyderabad, Karnataka and Maharashtra, Karnataka. What does it indicate? Now, simple statistics, but if you go deep, then you will see the backwardness of these districts on all indicators of human development index and the occurrence of this phenomenon and their migration or displacement to these cities, maybe through various trafficking networks. So then you start asking many other questions. But if you see the variables, in those backward districts, education or literacy rate is very low. Opportunity for employment is very low. So economic backwardness, intellectual backwardness or literacy backwardness, and the penetration of new kinds of thinking in terms of gender equality or importance of girl child not happening due to the stronghold of custom. And when we were doing those, I mean, there were 10,000 respondents, and then 3,000 respondents were given opportunity to narrate their story. So 3,000 narratives, they were further exemplifying what we found in terms of statistical data. So what we do here is, in terms of statistical procedures, we summarize and then draw statistical inference, and interrelationship between variables also we see. And then while reporting, we combine the qualitative and the quantitative, and we connect it to the original purpose and the hypothesis or the research question and affirm or answer the questions. So this is the full picture of a typical research. And in case of law, that research has got a certain code, which is different from other research. So in a typical research, this is what we see. In scientific research, that experiment dimension is in the lab's controlled condition. In social research or behavioral research, that controlled condition is in terms of collecting responses to the stimulus in a given population. Correct? The example of mock trial that I told you. We can give many others. Now let us come to how legal research is distinguished from other research. We draw on all those methodologies, but we draw it for the purpose of study of rules, study of legal principles, concepts, theories and doctrines. We study the decided cases, we study the legal institutions like the tribunals or the courts, and legal problems, issues or questions, sometimes a combination of some or all of them. I may have, just like cutting a watermelon, one of the poets used to say, Ramanujan, that how do you cut a watermelon? You can cut a watermelon in five different ways, isn't it? One is simply throw it on the ground and what happens? The pulse comes out and the skin remains there. The skin is hard to break. Second could be systematic cutting. Keep it on a table, on a beautiful tray, make it presentable, cut it in a very designed way. Some of our friends used to make floral designs out of watermelon by cutting it with some special kind of knife or cutters. Then one of our friends said that she finds it very tasty when she makes a hole on top and then artfully removes the lid, fills it with sugar and leaves it for 2 hours, because the entire pulp of watermelon is watery, so it absorbs the sugar. Already watermelon is sweet, but it becomes sweeter, and we Indians have a great palate for sweet. So it becomes very tasty, and she will cut it open after that. Then there is another technique. What is that technique? Cut it into slices and scoop out in a designed fashion, and that scoop of watermelon looks as if it's a different dessert. So one watermelon in different ways. Similarly, one legal research can have a permutation and combination of all of this. How do you do that? We did one research on agrarian, I will show you another example, because that I'll reserve for law reform. One of my master's students got married when she was in the final semester. So she was forced to visit Jabalpur, because her husband was in Jabalpur, nephew of ex-Supreme Court Judge Justice Sirpurkar. So when she was traveling in Jabalpur railway station, she noticed these marble crafts, small marble crafts, small, small designs made out of marble. Then she asked them. She said these marble, she also found them to be different from Agra marble or Jaipur marble, because she is familiar with all of these things. When she asked, they said this marble is special because it is drawn from Bhedaga, which is on the Narmada bank. And she is IPR specialization student. So there was a kind of flash in her head. Why can't I do a separate kind of idea about the IPR in this marble, because it is from Bhedaga. And it is made by these artisans who were apparently nomadic and poor. And there was already marble craft brand created by Agra, because of Taj Mahal being a marble, what you call, colosseum. And then the Jaipur marble is equally famous, because all of you know in Bangalore it has a very high market with the rich people. So this is how she was thinking. Then she came to me and she said, if we are doing a GI research on this, can we think of a GI for this? See, initiative by a student who was barely 22, 23. And then we started seeing how GI case has been developed in other cases. There were cases under the WTO, you know, the convention, the provisions, and how Scotch whiskey case was developed, how champagne was developed as a case. So the place and the product were synonymous with each other. Similarly, the famous Basmati or infamous Basmati case was coming up, was already there. So we started seeing how Bhedaghat marble case study could be developed and made into a case for geographical indication. Then that's not enough. Then you read it with access and benefit share. I mean, fair share in the outcome. So we created an analysis. We compared, we drew parallels. Finally, the model that we created was the possibility of a management institute or a commercial organization holding hand and developing this art and finding a proper market. Now Rama is based in Jabalpur, so she has joined the Jabalpur National Law School as a visiting faculty. So I was suggesting now is the time for you to develop it as a with the onset of Amazon and all these online spaces. So similarly, we are doing a case of Iktak sarees, Iktak art, you have in Belgaum as well. How to put it on a launch pad of online platform and protecting the rights of these original stewards of knowledge. So this is where you see there is a rule, GI rule, we have the GI Act as well, we have the GI Registration Authority. There is a principle, there is a concept of GI which has emanated from WTO. And then there are theories and doctrines which talk about the original owners of the knowledge and its linkage with the locality, and how GI is a combination of what? Copyright and trademark. So decided cases, legal institutions, legal problems and questions, combination of all of them. So our research, starting from law, looked at management, looked at the deeper issues, and looked at the autonomy of those little group of artisans who were engaged with this as a family occupation. Another student of mine did on Assam's Mugasit. And she went to that place, interviewed those people, and she saw. Hers was looking at Mugasit, GI is already given, but she was looking at post GI, post grant, how is the benefit really flowing to them, especially from the export promotion dimension? So increasingly interdisciplinary, but without losing the rigor of law. Now, where do we bring the rules from? Earlier we said it is rules, principles, concepts, theories. Now we explain that. Rules come from, basically constitution is a mother document, but any other system, statute. Principles come from, for example, privity of contract, natural justice. There are many legal principles. For example, contracts have to be observed in good faith. And how negotiable instruments, section 138 cases are proliferating in India. This is where a good research could go in. The background of these cases is very interesting. Concepts and theories or doctrine, it is about explaining them or disagreeing with them or creating a new theory or proposition in the light of changing circumstances. Most of the researchers sometimes come out with concrete dimension of how the legislation is limited or how the case, how the judging process or judicial process has limited the interpretation, or there has been a logical error. Sometimes Supreme Court has confessed that there has been a historical error in judgments. So if law researchers were alert, this would have come to light earlier itself. Then, matter with the bearing in law. So sometimes customary principles or practices with the force of law. Look at Shabarimala, for example. Practices which are against gender equality, but they have a force of law. So now the secular constitutional law and these practices having force of law have come at loggerheads. We are not saying whether it is right or wrong. As researchers, we are there to observe the phenomena and comment about it. So there can be practical research, theoretical research. What kind of practical research? Like we had this, you know, in India, before they recognized peacock as a national bird, they had recognized a bird called Great Indian Bustard. You know about it? That bird was supposed to be huge and it imitated the look of an emu or what is that, ostrich. And because of its name, our national leaders did not want that bird to be national bird because it had a... In Maharashtra, they had identified huge tracts of land as the sightings of this Great Indian Bustard as a bird on the verge of extinction. The bird has already been on the verge of extinction. They should have created sanctuaries for that, researchers for that, special, like how you have the tiger reserve, special reserves for that. But in the name of the bird, lot of lands were taken up and there was no concern for the ecological or other kind of concerns. Whereas it was a political attempt to control huge tracts of land. So some of the farmers in the adjoining area, under the leadership of one of our students, put this question through a public interest litigation. Now that is where we see it is a practical research. So he did a practical research and it showed only 4 birds were sighted in last 30 years. But there were 400 acres of land kept for Great Indian Bustard's preservation. So out of 4, how 400 acres are going to be useful, nobody knows. In those 30-40 years, so many families are virtually in poverty, especially in Maharashtra's Vidarbha area. So Rahul made a case on this and the case was admitted and denotification of that land was suggested by the court in the decision, Bombay High Court. So this is where practical research is something that comes up. There are many other cases, you know, public interest litigation every now and then are, that is what I will give as example for action research, because you are actually looking at the ground and you are developing the gaps in the law. I'll do it in the law reform research later on, but this example should be good enough for you. So research is about that going round in a circle. Going round in a circle follows a pattern, isn't it? It's investigating the same phenomenon in a systematic manner. You are searching closely, you are searching carefully, you are inquiring to discover the truth. And it is not simply searching, it's a trained, your eyes are trained, your approach is trained. So it's a trained scientific investigation, which means that not any evidence, but the best evidence which is taken into consideration. What is the best evidence? That best evidence goes through the check gates of reasonable, prudent standards, you know, just and reasonable standards. empirical standards, validated, free of bias, you know, so rationality. So this is how it is defined. So with that first concept of legal research, I mean, very first concept of examples and then legal research, now we'll look at what are the usual objectives in legal research and who does legal research? Who does? I have listed the people. Why do you do legal research? How many of you have done a small legal research? You don't agree you have done a legal research, but you have done a legal research. When you are formulating your responses to your assignment topics related to law, it may not be, some of us don't agree that we have done legal research because we have a certain notion of legal research. Because we believe that only Austin did legal research or Thomas Aquinas did legal research. That's pure doctrinal research. Any research which has a bearing on law. Would you agree? How many of you have done a research with a bearing on law? All of you, almost. By bearing, we mean the response of law or observing that with reference to law. You would have done historical legal institution, for example. You would have done. So, students do the research. Students also do as interns. Any one of you has done research as intern? Yeah, stand up. Tell me about the research you have done. Two, three of you are there.
Yeah. Yeah. Tell. Well, ma'am, this was long back when I was probably in the 2012 maybe.
Yeah.
So when I was probably in the second year, and I was interning with Mr. Kuwaya.
Yeah.
And at that point of time, the sugarcane commission, the tariffs that were charged, that was varying, which was challenged by the sugarcane
cultivators.
Yeah, thank you. And in this regard, since Mr. Kuwaya has taken up the matter, we had to do a lot of research based on how the previous cases have helped the cultivators when tariffs were wrongly charged and the government was not given what was initially agreed but was subsequently manipulated for some reason or the other. So that research really helped them and they were happy.
So you were doing research on cases, series of cases, and you were trying to establish a pattern. A pattern of not delivering what was promised.
Right.
Yeah. Thank you.
Anybody else? I can see you're putting your hand up. Yeah. Can you tell us? Are you okay?
Yes. So basically, I did a research on anti-money laundering related to the Prevention of Money Laundering Act. And basically, we had to find politically exposed persons and go back and check their social, economical, and news-related background. Yes, that was in compliance job. That's what we were. I was working, so it was a part of the compliance field.
You were working where?
In Jury Matrix, in a clutch group, in one of the firms.
In one of the firms.
Yes.
You know, law firms are very advanced in doing the research.
So you were trying to get this data in order to.
To build a database.
So creating the database, creating the data. So did you see the different purposes? Yeah. Anybody else who wants to share? So it's not that students do not know about legal research and we are teaching ABC of legal research. In some or other way, you would have done some kind of deeper investigation in a scientific manner, at least in terms of collecting the data, facts, as they said, or collection of facts with the particular pattern being exposed to serve a litigation or to assist the judge to arrive at a decision. Anybody who has clerked with the judge? Yeah,
please explain the kind of research you would have done for the judge. You can be keeping the confidentiality.
See, confidentiality clauses come here. Yeah.
Generally, you can.
I worked under Justice B.S. Patil. We had a lot of matters related to land acquisition and money laundering.
Okay. So what was the research that you did? We don't want to know the outcome, but...
So, we focus on specific questions of law. For example, there's one case where you have to see whether the concurrence of the financial department was...
That's about money laundering. We'll leave that. Land acquisition, because she gave some example.
Land acquisition, we had many cases, and there was a lot of contradiction between two Supreme Court judgments.
So you were doing more of...
Yes.
Judicial research,
yes,
not
dissidents.
Yeah.
Now, when a judge is dealing with the problem, and when a judge is doing the research, thank you all, very good, very valuable information. When judge is doing the research, judge is doing between the premises which is presented to him or her by the two contesting parties. So the investigation is limited to that, but on both sides. When a lawyer is doing the research is on one side of the case to present it as the best case. The judge has to decide which is a better case. So there is an independent research that the judge does, independent of the research that is brought to the table by the two contesting lawyers at any stage, right from trial court to the Supreme Court. When an academic or a student could do the research in our academic arena, we have no limit. We can even do a metacritic of what the judge has done. That is the beauty of academic research. But when a particular organization does the research, as she said, it's more about collecting certain type of facts so that they have that repository of knowledge. So different purposes are being served by different people. So this is where there is no hierarchy of saying that lawyers research. Lawyers always claim that we are the best. And what you academics or what your teachers can teach you kind of thing. But don't believe them, because now you will see the value. We have a 360 degree view possibility, whereas they have to see 180 degree or sometimes 90 degree in relation to their case. So lawyers in government or private sector, law reform agencies. In India, we don't have independent law reform agencies, although non-governmental organizations and law schools sometimes present proposals to the government to improve the law. Sometimes even stakeholders. For example, All India Christian Law Board presented the reforms that the Christian community required in the Indian Marriage Act, where the Indian Divorce Act, where the divorce grounds for man and woman were different. So there was a kind of subtle discrimination which was prevailing there. So sometimes law reform proposals may come from the community or stakeholders. Those assisting parliamentary committees, commissions, judges, teachers of law, writers, NGOs, etc. do the research. Like I was reading an NGO report from Tamil Nadu about Nagoya Protocol, where they were talking about how the Nagoya Protocol has not served the interest of indigenous communities. So this is where you see 10% of the legal problems come to the court. 90% is existing in the society, which have to be decided out of court, or sometimes they go to these bad sources of justice, like mafia justice, landlord justice kind of thing, or they may be compromising, sacrificing the true facets of justice. So legal research is not only law research, it is justice research. So law research in terms of how far law is serving the ends of justice. Why legal research? Legal research is done by academics for books or paper. It is done for problem solving. It may be done for arguing a case. It may be done to draft an enactment or amend also sometimes, to advise a client, to find the latest position of law, as she was talking about, to review the law, to determine the inadequacies in the law, to make recommendations for new law or amending the law, sometimes for preparation of law books. I mean, it's a big industry now, law book industry. I hope I can move further. Then we understand there is a wide variety of purpose that legal research serves. So the dynamic character of law is the one which requires legal research to determine the law applicable in the situation, or to examine the law established by the courts to determine the scope of a situation, to solve the problems, actual problems. To ascertain the relevance, validity, to examine the weakness, to compare provisions between jurisdictions, you know. So this is why legal research is done. Sometimes we also identify advantages and disadvantages, you know, conflict resolution. For example, there was one book called Sociology of Law, which was written by Simon Roberts, and long ago in UK. In that he talks about Polynesian Island, which is off the New Guinea, Papua New Guinea area. So there, he built on the research that Malinowski had done for anthropology to understand these indigenous people. Now what they found was, the contrast between modern legal system and tribal legal system. In modern legal system, conflict has to be resolved according to the rationality of justice, whereas in tribal legal system, it was more about survival, you know. So somebody being put out of the community, excommunication itself was sufficient for the as the highest form of punishment. There were no prisons. An equivalent, a rudimentary form of prisons existed, but the systems of dispute resolution, like what we call as negotiation, mediation, good office, these systems, and even the current remnant of tribunals, current tribunals, all these existed in those societies. So Simon Roberts' work stimulated the evolution of labor law institutions to begin with, you know, settlement of dispute. Because England at that time was growingly industrializing, and the power of the workforce, mass of people working in these industries, you know, the cotton factories, etc. At that time, disputes had to be resolved in a very amicable way for the sustenance of these industries. So they drew their rationality from the tribal systems, because in tribal systems, the survival was the priority. It's not the ego war between two disputants, you know. So this fed into the modern legal systems. See, we always think ours is the best, but there are so many lessons to be learned from them. So this created the whole plethora of alternative dispute resolution mechanism, which first started with labor law and labor dispute resolution mechanisms, and later entered the other arena like business and other dispute resolution systems. How many of you read the life history of Gandhi as a lawyer? So Gandhi was very much very good in settling disputes outside the court. That was his major tactic, which you know how he involved in solving the biggest problem of the nation. So dispute resolution as a skill also requires a lot of research. And appropriate, we call now ADRs not as alternative dispute resolution, but appropriate dispute resolution. Appropriate mechanism is chosen after thorough research. Sometimes we use theories, and we try to see how far these theories are applicable. What example I can give? We were using the triangulation method in one of the researches, and we used a grounded theory in terms of we used a film in the center, and we wanted to show how the displacement, internal displacement, results in violation of human rights, not in that locality alone, but beyond that locality. So we were using the case study of Chandni Bar. And one was film as a text, second was this grounded theory of human rights, third was going and watching the dance bar girls. At that time, dance bars were still prevalent in Mumbai. So we did this research in the context of the Media Institute. So that is where three dimensions were taken, and they were trying to explain the phenomenon of vulnerability. So we use a theory, or we use an authoritative work, and we show the correctness or validity in relation to some phenomenon that is prevalent. Book review is also an exercise on that. Anybody has read a book review? How does a book review begin? It doesn't say this book has got four chapters. It begins with a core idea of the book, how it was developed, a few lines about that, and then you analyze the book, describe it and also analyze. Then you show the flaws in relation to that basic theory or concept that you picked up, and you show how this book has made a good contribution, but it also has left some gaps for future research to come in. Sometimes we use research, legal research, to explain the operation of principles in actual fact situation, or some social phenomenon or a problem. For example, we wrote an article in American Journal of Humanities and Social Sciences. We were trying to explain tradition and modernity as two opposite poles. How the Supreme Court has been juggling to connect these two poles. And we, 4 years ago, we used the Shabarimala case as the entry point, as it was prevailing then. And then we argued how gender equality as a sacrosanct principle under the Constitution has exacted a price from the judicial process in terms of how it is a principle not to be compromised with. So we were showing with the Awadh case and a series of cases across religions. So there we are using principles in actual fact situation and a social phenomenon of tradition and modernity clashing, and how this polarity has been revisited by Supreme Court in different cases. For teachers also, research is useful because it stimulates their own research, it contributes to advancement of knowledge, it makes them not to take stand without investigation. And that investigation is not based on likes and dislikes. We had a teacher who never liked and the idea of upholding the rights of the same-sex couples. So we made him investigate the point, and students also. So eventually, the teaching becomes more and more dispassionate, without personal bias coming into teaching. Therefore, it is not confined to the library. You learn from every resource. So legal research about law and legal rules, asking the rights question, whether those rights exist or not, implemented or not, how short of are they of implementation. It teaches us how to look at the world from the justice angle in terms of establishing that equilibrium, in terms of equity and fairness. It gives us how the law ticks to deliver justice or how it hasn't ticked to deliver justice in a given case. It opens the inquiring mind, and it's not just limited to pure law research. It joins hands with other forces such as sociology or business or science. So the framework is values, justice and rights. All these three are put together in a research when we are doing a legal research. I hope that part is clear to all of you. Yeah. In this class, if I ask, is there anybody who is prepared with a research idea? Put your hand up. How many of you want to do an article? Good. Which theme?
Jurisdiction in cyberspace.
Let us take that concept. What is the uniqueness of cyberspace? I mean, how has cyber technology evolved? Internet, with the evolution of internet, and internet evolved as part of
research.
Army research by who?
Tim Berners-Lee.
Yeah, but where was the need to evolve it? If you look at the evolution of internet and computer technology, and then the internet as a kind of line of computers, it evolved out of the military industry complex of NASA of America. So you will see the challenge in cyberspace is that it is transnational. So hitherto, the established idea of jurisdiction does not become relevant there because it has a grasp which is beyond territories. Right now, jurisdiction is bound up with the sovereignty, it is bound up with state, it is bound up with boundaries, therefore, isn't it? So what could be the alternative in this case? States entering into a kind of treaty or a contract, and thereby having that apportionment of jurisdiction, shared responsibility. And then we have a new player who seems to be more powerful or challenging the very power of the state. Who is this? ISP, Internet Service Provider, who has a better hold, and power doesn't come from territory, power doesn't come from money, power comes from technology, the know-how. So this is where ISP's power has become a bigger challenge. And ISP has a very dubious nature. On the one hand, they also have a fundamental right as business operators. On the other hand, they have a very powerful technology in their hand. This technology has come to them because of their own investment. So you have to become master of, or you have to reap the fruit of your power and your hard work, isn't it? See the justice, the idea of justice there, idea of rights there. So this is where the whole legality of controlling cyber power, cyberspace, is a very, very difficult jurisprudential question. Our existing jurisprudence of Thomas Aquinas, Hart, Dworkin, none of them seem to serve the reality of cyber world or netizen. And the qualification to dominate that world and to reap the benefit is familiarity with the technology, mastery of the technology, which your age group is masters of, and we are a little slow in that. So that is where your literature review will have to do a survey of jurisdictional questions in relation to cyber crime coming in from the survey of general literature, and then the documentation of cases or conflicts, existing, published, unpublished work. And when you're doing, you will have some 1 crore material. You can't use all of that as your literature. So similar looking literature, by reading the blurb of the book or by reading the abstract of the article, you will have to eliminate. So this is how, before she embarks on limiting her research, raising her research question or hypothesis, she will have to see what others have done, because it is assumed that knowledge accumulates with everybody's work. What is already known should be the basis of your learning, and you avoid and familiarity.